Hey everybody, Alan Arnette here with another podcast episode on the blog on alanarnette.com. It is, what is Tuesday, February 28th, last day of February, and look who I have on the screen with me, none other than Becks Ferry. Hey Becks, how you doing?
Hey Alan, I'm really well, and thanks for having me back on. It's really nice to be here. Just saying, I can't believe it's been so long. It feels like yesterday.
I know. It was November of 2021 that we talked and did a similar podcast. And there we were talking about you went with John Gupta, classy British guide, to go climb some mountains, and you ended up climbing, got to the summit of Everest and Lhotse and K2.
Yeah,
we could just stop right there, right? But you also got to 7,500 meters on Makalu, and 7,800 on Dhaulagiri, and then you hit the Fore summit like everybody else did prior to a couple of years ago on Manaslu. So, you had a pretty good run. You know, I was joking with you earlier. I kind of call you like the accidental mountain climber, the accidental climber, because it was never, you didn't grow up. You grew up in an athletic family. You grew up as a runner. We're going to get into that. But you never grew up, you know, reading, you know, the British mountaineering journals and all that stuff, talking about climbing, and said, one day I want to go climb Mount Everest as a young lady, did you?
No, I mean, I think, as I said before, my dad was a bit of a frustrated mountaineer. And so I was aware of the history of a lot of these mountains, but actually he never climbed them. He always wanted to climb them, but grew up schlepping around in Scotland, and mostly, like we're saying, running around. You know, he was a formidable runner, so holidays were always spent following him, running around these Scottish highlands and Welsh hills. But you're right, I suppose the mountaineering probably followed really on the back of all the running that I did and the racing in places like the Himalayas and other mountain ranges. So yeah, possibly a bit of an accidental mountaineer.
So not to bury the lead, but you are going to return to the Himalaya this spring, and you're going to go have a second row with Makalu, but you're going to add a twist to it. So the floor is yours. Lay it out. What are you up to this time?
Yeah, so you're right. So I'm going back to Makalu, and I know that we spoke about it before. And Makalu, even though I didn't reach the summit last time, I just loved the mountain. I loved everything about it. The experience after having been on Everest and Lhotse, which was incredible, but so different to what I experienced on Makalu, which was this, you know, beautiful mountain, slightly more technical as well. You know, it was a real sort of climbing mountain. And this really small, wonderful base camp full of people that have subsequently then become, you know, really good friends.
Becks?
Camp all the way to
I think we lost you.
Oh, okay.
So just I can edit that out. So just go, let's get, pause for a count of three, and then just pick, let's, I tell you what, let me pick up where I cued you. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Because all of a sudden you just froze. So in 2021, you went to Makalu, you reached 7,500 meters, and now you're going to go give it another go, huh? But there's a twist to it. So the floor is yours. Tell us all about it.
Yeah, you're right, Alan. I'm saying that I remember talking to you at the time about Makalu and what a great mountain it was and what a great experience. I found it personally after having been on Everest and Lhotse, which was incredible, but really big and busy. And then I went to Makalu, which was this quiet, more technical type of mountain, and this really small base camp full of really lovely people who subsequently then become, you know, pretty good friends, and interestingly enough, a couple of trail runners as well. And after the year of climbing with John, there's sort of a twofold thing here. Is I ended up sharing a stage at the Kendall Mountain Festival with this incredible lady called Jenny Tuff. who I'm sure you've come across. And I was actually, I kind of felt embarrassed in many ways to be on the stage with this lady who was an absolute shero. You know, she was single-handedly doing things. I was like, oh my goodness, you know, this is incredible what you're doing. You are really raising the glass ceiling for women. You know, you are out there and you are doing pure adventure and exploration. And my goodness, you know, I would love to do what you've done. And then another friend of mine ran back last year from Kanchenjunga. And I looked at Kanchenjunga and I thought, that's a little bit too far. Makalu, if I'm going to run, so I'm going to run back from, I'm going to try to climb Makalu. And I'd like to try and climb without any oxygen. All the mountains that I've been on, I've used oxygen apart from the attempt in the autumn when I was on Manaslu. But obviously the mountain had other ideas for that and we aborted. And I personally, as an endurance athlete, I wanted to try and experience that physical kind of threshold of what it feels like from my own personal perspective. Again, I know the debate on O's or no O's is
yeah.
And first and foremost, I'm an endurance athlete, a runner, and have spent many, many years running in the Himalayas and other mountain ranges. And I just thought, this is incredible. Like, what an opportunity to go and try and climb a mountain that I love, but also be like Jenny Tarth, who has the best surname ever. It's like, I need to, you know, think of a new surname for myself. It's like Tough Berry. You know, incredible, like to navigate myself, to plan the route, pure adventure and pure exploration, and hopefully something which is going to, you know, inspire, as Jenny inspired me, other people to have a go at doing these things.
Okay, so wait a minute. Let's make sure that the audience is catching what you're saying, because I think you kind of buried the lead there a little bit. You're gonna go attempt Makalu without supplemental oxygen, come back down to base camp, maybe take a shower, maybe not, and then you're going to run,
yeah, over
trails back to Kathmandu.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Let's everybody pause for a moment. Let that sink in. So this makes the Everest marathon running from a Gorge Shep back to Namshi look like a, you know, just a warm up. So how far is it?
So it's roughly just over 200 miles, about 220 miles with about 25,000 meters of elevation. Oh yeah, up and down. So yeah. When I was looking at the route,
are you okay? I know you're the mother of five. Are you okay?
Yeah, this is why I run a long way. Having five children, it's the only way that I can get any peace and quiet. I love it.
So what's the elevation? What will you start at Makalu Base Camp in Kathmandu? What's the elevation?
So the elevation at Makalu Base Camp is about 5,800, and then obviously end up in Kathmandu, which is 1,400 meters. So we're in meters, yeah.
So about 12,000 feet, about 4,000 meters roughly.
Yeah, exactly. Hey,
but you're going downhill.
Yeah, yeah. But like most of these things in the Himalayas, you're going downhill, but you're going up. And I was looking at the route, and you know, when you're looking at the map, you think, oh, it doesn't look so bad. But actually then you zoom in and you look at the profile and you think, yeah, this is maybe I've bitten off more than I can chew here. But that's part of the appeal, that there's, you know, I know there's going to be difficult times. And I think there's that element. I've always been someone who's been quite honest in terms of having a go at things and being prepared to fail. And I think out of all the things that I've attempted, and for example, you know, the Makalu experience, the first time round, we didn't reach the summit, but I learned a lot on that mountain. You know, I learned a lot about perseverance, about patience, about teamwork, about respect for the mountain, respect for the environment, about being able to say, no, you know, this is enough, and we are going to return. And again, the same on Dhaulagiri, when the conditions just weren't conducive to trying to get to the summit, even though we were, you know, within hair's breadth of actually, you know, summiting, it just wasn't safe. So I think from these things, and I know, yes, I'm going to suffer, but I'm going to learn a lot about being able to, talking to Jenny as well, being able to be happy and comfortable about being alone and making decisions as well for me. And that's what I'm really excited about, is to sort of be this solo person.
Let's break this into two parts, the climb and the run. So yeah. On the climb, who are you going with? Is John going to come with you again? Or I know he's off pursuing his IFMGA certification, so kind of for a little while.
Yeah, so you're right, he's doing the IFMGA guiding scheme. And I've got to a point now where I've made, I guess, a lot of contacts and friends, and I'm going to use the logistics for Himalayan Guides, who supports Madison. And I feel really happy about that. I have one Sherpa with me. And the idea is that I'm aware that, as you say, you know, sort of being a relatively accidental climber, who I am and what I am and what I'm not, you know, on the mountain. And I'm not unsafe, I'm not dangerous, I'm not a risk taker.
Right.
But I want to try and be as autonomous as possible. And to, like I said, the whole idea of this is to be more self-sufficient. And yes, you know, I'm aware I do need someone for safety, more than anything. So I've got a really good climbing Sherpa with me, but that's it. And we'll just use the base camp logistics.
Then you just teased, you said, I'm going to be running alone. And so are you not going to have any support running?
So when I leave base camp, it's me. This is pure solo. And obviously I'll have various, you know, sort of communications with me, like an inReach and a sat phone, so people can see where I am. And not that anyone probably even bother. My kids be like, oh, you know, she's, where's she gone? Oh, she disappeared.
We'll get to your kids in a minute. Keep going though.
But no, that's the idea, is that I'm totally alone with just one bag. And then we'll run from Makalu base camp and go over the pass all the way back to Kathmandu. So
how long do you think it'll take you?
I think I'm planning roughly about between 10 days to two weeks. I'm hoping more. It depends how long I decide to stay in Namche. You know, if I can't get past Panorama Lodge and the heated blankets and the
disco.
And the cafe,
the bakery, you know, yeah.
maybe 2 weeks, but
you have to carbo load, so you have to go to the bakery. So
absolutely, and I have to stay there all day. I was thinking my sole objective is to get back safely to Kathmandu, and I think yes, I have an idea of roughly how I'm going to break it down daily, but it takes as long as it takes.
And so what do you think is going to be the biggest challenge? Is it running at altitude? Is it the uneven terrain? Is it the constant stress in your body of elevation gain, elevation loss? What do you think is going to be the biggest couple of challenges?
I think the biggest challenge, you're right, is going to be the running at altitude. And I think the running at altitude, actually having done a no-os climb, this is, you know, I've done a number of hard, really hard endurance events where you've had to get up and run the following day, but never on the back of doing an 8,500-meter mountain. So I think this could possibly be a really big challenge for me. And that's also exciting, I'm quite interested in the process of these things as well. Like, I'm very process driven with, I suppose you could say, it's more process over outcome. Like, I like the training and I like the science behind the training, you know, and I like, I'm interested in how the body works and how it doesn't work. So I'm trying to replicate things at home for running I have a friend of mine who's very kindly given me a hypoxic mm-hmm. machine. So I'm sleeping in a plastic bag, and woke up last night with like something dripping on my head. I realized because it was so cold outside and so hot in the plastic bag that it was
raining inside.
What am I doing? You know, sort of rigged up to the treadmill and just basically trying to replicate the body, and then finding out and doing a little bit of testing as well to see how the bloods react. So it is kind of a little bit more scientific, and that's interesting as well. Like, there's going to be a bit of data behind this. So it does have a kind of a process to it. So, you know, and it might be that I fall to pieces, I don't know, but I'm really interested to see.
So is this going to be tell me more about your previous running, you know, your running career and stuff, marathons and long distances. This is going to be 225 miles. This, you know, this is not a marathon. This is, you know, a marathon times 10.
Yeah, I mean,
and back to back, and coming off of a NOOS 8,000-meter mountain, so you're really stacking the deck for difficulty. So, talk about what your history has been in these long runs.
Yeah, so it's been, I think maybe you touched upon it before. I initially started off as a track runner, mm-hmm. and was very much sort of 800 meters and 1500 meters, so it was fast. And it wasn't really until I actually had the children that I sort of progressed into this more endurance running, and I just found it really suited me. I mean, I ran when I was growing up from village to village. You know, it wasn't unusual to go and see a friend and run there. So it's always been something that's been like something I've done every day. But the longer distances really didn't start until probably 2014, 2015, when I did the Marathon des Sables, which is a multi-stage race. And this multi-stage format seemed to suit me quite well, in terms of I'd start off okay, and then I'd get progressively better and better and better. So I'm hoping in my mind, like, you know, this is perfect for me, Alan. This is, you know, this makes perfect sense to go climb a mountain and then run 200 miles and
perfect. Yeah. Hey, you know, we have a lot in common, because I ran track in high school, and I'm proud to say I broke the 4 minute mark.
Wow. That's
in the 800 meter dash. But so moving on, what is it about running? Is it the adrenaline that gets to you? Is it the endorphins? Is it the challenge? Talk about the mental and the physiological benefits that you get from running like this.
It's for me, it's almost like I was having this conversation with a friend the other day, actually, because a couple of weeks ago I actually did something which wasn't really running, but was a really big endurance event in Canada, in the Yukon, where I pulled a sled for for 100 miles. So I've totally and utterly shelved any Antarctic endeavors that I was thinking I would like to go to the poles. No, not anymore. Never pulling a sled again.
That's for dogs.
It was absolute torture. And, and I live in the Cotswolds, which is where I am, is really flat. So, and there's no snow. So I trained with dragging a tire around the roads, and you know, the neighbors were just like, what are you doing?
I put my tire back on my car. Quit it.
Yeah, there she goes again, you know, pulling this thing. But it was a really interesting experience, actually, because it pushed me.
Yeah.
Even though it wasn't running, it really pushed me mentally. And again, it taps into, it was perfect training for what I'm going to be doing, actually, because I was alone for pretty much 34 hours on this race. And mentally, that takes you into another realm where you have to be present. Like, you can't project about what's happening in the future. Otherwise, I just find that you panic about, you know, time is going so slowly. And it's almost like it's this opportunity to be happy and comfortable with your own company, and, you know, to sort of think about things or to not. And it's almost like meditation in a very strange way for me anyway. You know, you get into this comfortable discomfort where you the body just seems to almost accept the pain and the suffering, and you know you just become so focused at being present that everything else just ebbs away. It's quite a strange feeling, and I think maybe most endurance runners would say that's perhaps what we crave and what we like about these events, that it takes you into a totally different realm.
Yeah, I think that's a similarity with high altitude mountain climbing as well, because even though you may be, you know, in a line of people or a queue of people and just, you know, the way it works out, but still you are kind of in your own bubble. And as you say, you have to be comfortable with being with yourself, and you've got to be comfortable with the discomfort. And so those two things together, it's not like you can just snap your fingers and stop, you know, when you're at 8,200 meters trying to go to the summit. Yeah, you can turn around. You can always stop when you're running, but that's not the point. The point is that accepting where you are and learning from that experience and finding what that limit is, and then finding the ability to push beyond it.
Yeah, and you're right, you know, there's exactly that. I think that's why I really, really like the high altitudes to go, for me personally, really, really well hand in hand, is that there are so many similarities between ultra running and endurance athletics, as you're right, being on these high altitude mountains. It's the same thing, patience, perseverance and persistence. And you're right, you know, you might be in a queue of people. You can't let, you know, you're thinking, oh, move, but you have to just acknowledge where you are and just be
within yourself.
Be with yourself and be comfortable. Otherwise, you know, mistakes are made, things happen. And I like that. Like it involves every facet of mind and body, and the similarities between the two are really, really, really great.
So you have five children, ages from 13 to 19. Do I have that right?
Yeah.
And so what do they think about mom? Or have they just gotten used to you doing some kind of different things?
Yeah, I think, you know, they're so used to it now. You know, for example, when I went to the Yukon, and they were like, what are you doing? And I was like, I'm dragging a sled for 100 miles. And they just were like, all right, okay. When are you back? You know, it's there's no sort of and then when I'm there, I get the same messages from them about, you know, not how are you, or it's like, where's my, have you done it yet? Have you finished? When are you back? But, you know, actually they're proud as well. I had, I was talking to one of them, Alice, who's 16, and she said, yeah, are you looking forward to it? And I said, I'm kind of looking forward to it, but also I'm nervous because I've never, you know, I've never operated like this. And she said, well, you'll be awesome, we think you're awesome, you're always awesome whatever you do. And you know, that moment of my goodness. And she said, oh, we're just so proud of you. And and I just kind of, and that's why I just think it, when I'm doing these things, yes, it takes me out the house for a long time, but they're the ones that are saying, in fact, my son had the, I always ask them, what do you think before I do these things? It's not like I agree to do them and then I just disappear. I always have a discussion with them. What do you think? And Tom, my son, said exactly, he's 17. He's just like, I think it's awesome what you do. I said, think you're completely nuts. He said, but we love you so much. And, you know, we're really proud of your mom.
You're completely nuts, but we're really proud of your mom. I mean, that pretty well, you know, bookends it.
Yeah. And he said, we wouldn't ever want to, you know, stop you from doing anything. And he said, if anything, we want you to do all these things because, you know, you've got to do it while you can, and you only get one shot at this, and it makes you happy, and you're happy, we're happy. And I was like, oh my goodness, you know, this is a 17-year-old boy. And then he asked me for some money to go to the
and bring me back a yak while you're at it. So
yeah, bring me back some presents.
It's always critically important to, you know, have the support of those that you leave behind. And one of the things Bond is saying is that, you know, you leave home with nothing left unsaid. And it sounds like that you're in the process of having those conversations with everybody that's important to you in your life, which I think is a long list. So.
Yeah, massively. And, you know, and it's every day, it's sort of, we end a conversation with, it's like, I love you, you know, and it really, you know, it comes from the heart. And I know when I'm out there, that it's they know that I will always come back and be there if anything happens, but to have that validation and that support from them gives me, you know, it makes me happy that I'm doing something that makes them proud, and also is fulfilling for me. And I'm not doing it to set records or to, you know, be the best. I'm doing it because I love it. Like, I actually love, you know, and it's a privilege to be, as you know, to be on these mountains. And they're really special places for me. And I found a lot of joy, irrespective of the debates about how you climb them, whatever. You know, for me, like I said, I'm aware of what I am and what I'm not. And I'm comfortable and happy with how I decide to do things, and being able to be in this incredible environment in the Himalayas is, you know, so many friends are saying, oh my goodness, you know, you're so lucky. It's like, yes, I am. It's a real privilege to be able to go to these places and to put a pair of trainers on and to run back. You know, I think, wow, how lucky am I? Or to set foot on Makalu again, and to feel like every mountain just has this really special, unique feel. Some, you know, like, for example, Manaslu in the autumn was definitely didn't want to be climbed. And you felt that, like, it was, you know, you have to have a, as cheesy as it sounds, like a synchronicity with nature. And I think that's what I've learned, is you have to respect people and the environment, and, you know, and you get back what you give out as well. And yeah, and I that's what I love. It's just so much more to me than going up and ticking a box and setting a record. It's the process, not the outcome, which is really important to me, and the people that you meet.
Well, I can't think of a better way to wrap this up. You know, I think you're definitely, this is going to be very challenging. You know, running that distance is challenging. Climbing an 8,000 meter mountain without oxygen, supplemental oxygen, is challenging. Combining them together is, you know, really, like I said earlier, upping the ante for the degree of difficulty. But, you know, I think you're approaching this in the right way, with respect, with humility, with confidence. And that's about all you can go into an endeavor like this with.
And chocolate, Alan. Chocolate.
Chocolate and coffee. You got it. Okay. Yes. Well, Bex, I know that we'll be following you along the way. Maybe we can touch base quickly over WhatsApp or something once you get to Makalu base camp. I'd love to talk to you before you go up and after you come back down and before you start running, have a quick, sure, you know, 2-minute check-in. That would be wonderful.
I don't know. I suspect it will probably be a very different story once I've, you know, returned to base camp. And like, how are you? I don't know.
What was I thinking?
I'm doing. No, I've got to run 200 miles.
Hey, have you reached out to John Gupta and asked him any words of wisdom?
I haven't actually yet, because he's the climber, he's not really the runner. So
right.
Other people, like I said, my good friend Rupert, who did a similar thing from Kanchenjunga, and so he's been, you know, great, a great sort of fountain of knowledge, and Jenny Tuff as well, from the kind of planning, and also Lizzie Hawker as well, who's this phenomenal runner. and a couple of very lucky to be able to run with a few Nepalese people when I'm in Kathmandu. And, you know, they've been really helpful in terms of basically trying to add on extra bits for the route. It's like, oh, you should take it. That's like, no, I just wanted to go as fast as possible.
While you're running, go over and check out this.
Over there. It's like, no.
if you're not careful, you're going to become the Messiah of the UK, you know.
I just Forrest Gump said, I just kept running and running some more.
run Bex run. All right, hey, listen, best of luck to you. We'll be following you, and very, very impressive. So
thank you, and thanks for having me back as well. It's nice to chat with you.
Always be safe. Run hard, climb high. I'm not sure what to say. Take care.
Thanks, Alan.